Rosalba, semoga agamamu bisa ajar kamu bisa jadi lebih baik ya daripada goblok dan biadab kayak begitu. Ya, shalom saudara-saudara. Tadi saya dikirimkan satu video, satu link video dari teman saya. Dan ternyata setelah saya buka, itu adalah video dari channel seorang Islam yang namanya Rosalba Official. Nah, ini adalah channelnya. Dan dalam video itu, dia rupanya mempostingkan sebuah potongan video saya. Ya. Jadi dari video saya yang asli itu dipotong. Nah, entah dia yang potong, ataukah dia hanya mempostingkan postingan potongan itu, saya nggak tahu. Tapi pokoknya yang dipostingkan oleh orang ini itu adalah potongannya. Dan wah, jadi sebenarnya di video saya yang asli itu judulnya itu adalah Paulus Rasul Segala Pendusta. Nah, sebenarnya itu video yang membahas suatu tuduhan dari satu channel yang namanya Cahaya Islam. Jadi channel Cahaya Islam itu membuat, mengangkat beberapa ayat Alkitab. Lalu dia menyimpulkan bahwa Paulus itu sebenarnya adalah rasul pendusta. Nah, jadi saya dalam rangka menanggapi itu. Ya. Karena itulah maka saya berikan judul Paulus Rasul Segala Pendusta, ada tanda tanyanya. Ya. Nah, dalam pendahuluan saya, waktu saya menceritakan itu, saya lalu mengatakan kalimat tertentu. Nah, itulah yang dipotong oleh si Rosalba ini ya. Dan wah, si Rosalba ini dengan begitu semangat. Bahkan dia memberikan judul bahwa Pendeta Ezra belum dimasuki Roh Kudus pada waktu khotbah. Nah, lebih tepatnya coba kita lihat itu video dia itu ya.
Sahabat official, jika Pendeta Ezra Sorul sedang sehat dan normal akalnya dan kesadarannya berada 100%, tidak lebih dan tidak kurang, maka beginilah ucapannya sebelum dia dirasuki Roh Kudus untuk memimpin jemaat di gerejanya. Semoga jemaatnya tersadarkan bahwa apa yang dikatakan oleh Pendeta Ezra Sorul ini benar sesuai dengan Bible-nya.
Paulus itu sebenarnya rasul pendusta. Dan karena itu kekristenan itu tidak lebih dari sebuah iman kepada dusta, karena kekristenan tidak berdiri atas ajaran Yesus, tapi sebaliknya atas ajaran Paulus yang penuh dengan dusta.
Saudara lihat kan? Nah, lalu kalau saudara baca komentarnya, wah, banyak orang berkomentar. Ya, ada yang mengecam saya, atau ada yang, wah, justru yang dikatakan itu benar. Jadi saya seolah-olah mengakui bahwa Paulus itu adalah pendusta, dan itu membuat mereka senang. Saya kira ya, ini si siapa namanya, Rosalba ini nih, ya, goblok ya. Saya nggak tahu dia yang potong video saya atau bukan ya.
Rupanya video kami mendapat reaction atau postingan langsung dari sang pendeta, sehingga beliau memberi judul seperti demikian. Sekalian kami juga ingin menjawab bahwa kami memang mendapatkan potongan video tersebut melalui sebuah aplikasi WhatsApp group tentang perdebatan antara umat Islam dan Kristen. Namun, dari makna yang disampaikan oleh Pendeta Ezra Sorul ini bahwa Rasul Paulusnya itu pendusta, sebuah polemik di dunia kekristenan itu sendiri. Sebagaimana akan kami tampilkan beberapa narasumber yang terpercaya sebagai peneliti Bible, bukan sebagai pendeta ya. Baik, akan coba kami jelaskan tentang latar belakang permasalahannya ya. Kalian silahkan simak baik-baik. Sebagai umat Islam, kita dianjurkan dan tidak pernah ada larangan untuk mempelajari kitab-kitabullah atau kitab-kitab terdahulu mulai dari Taurat, Zabur, dan Injil yang mereka klaim sebagai kitab suci mereka. Sementara mereka beranggapan bahwasannya umat Islam hanya memiliki Al-Quran saja sebagai kitab sucinya. Tentu saja hal itu salah besar ya, sahabat official. Karena agama Yahudi dan Kristen itu sebenarnya tidak ada. Yang ada hanya agama para nabi dengan konsep penyerahan diri atau berserah diri hanya kepada Allah. Sebagaimana firman Allah berikut ini.
Halo teman-teman, berjumpa lagi dengan saya Brother Phil. Kali ini kita akan membahas seorang wanita yang tidak malu menyebarkan dusta terhadap pendeta Ezra Soru. Saya tidak tahu apakah dia sedang jalankan ajaran agamanya atau tidak. Atau dia sedang membuktikan hadis nabinya, di mana seorang wanita itu memiliki dua kekurangan yaitu dalam agama dan akalnya. Dan berikut ini mungkin praktek dari hadis nabi tersebut.
Jika pendeta Ezra Soru sedang sehat dan normal akalnya dan kesadarannya berada 100%, tidak lebih dan tidak kurang, maka beginilah ucapannya sebelum dia dirasuki Roh Kudus untuk memimpin jemaat di gerejanya.
Kita sudah saksikan bersama betapa liciknya perempuan dalam video yang menurut hadis kurang dalam akal dan agamanya. Dia memfitnah pendeta Ezra Soru dengan cara memotong video khotbah pendeta Ezra, sehingga pernyataan pendeta Ezra terlihat sedang menjelekkan Rasul Paulus. Semua orang yang berakal mendengar potongan video itu tentunya akan menolak jika ada seorang pendeta yang mendapat pengajaran dari Rasul Paulus justru menuduh Rasul Paulus yang bukan-bukan. Tapi, karena wanita ini kekurangan dalam akal, pantas saja dia mengatakan demikian.
Nah, sahabat official, berhubung channel Rosalba Official ini di-roasting kesana kemari oleh channel-channel Kristen, maka ada baiknya kalian simak baik-baik bagaimana penjelasan para pakar Bible berikut ini. Mereka adalah para peneliti yang akan berbicara tentang apa yang dikatakan oleh pendeta Ezra Soru. Tentunya, sesuai dengan tema video pendeta Ezra Soru, apakah Rasul Paulus itu seorang pendusta? Nah, untuk mengenalinya tentunya kita harus tahu dulu tentang kedua ajaran tersebut. Apakah ajaran dari Paulus itu sejalan dengan ajaran Yesus? Jika tidak sejalan, maka apa yang dikatakan oleh pendeta Ezra Soru dalam potongan video tersebut benar adanya? Mari kita simak bagaimana pakar Bible berbicara dan kita simak polemik yang terjadi di negara Kristen.
If you had to line all the apostles up, I get the vibe that for you, Paul is the cornerstone of the whole story.
Well, the reason I think he is somewhat different from what a lot of people say. Some people say that Paul invented Christianity, and that can't be true because Paul was persecuting Christians before he became a Christian, and so if he invented Christianity, he would have had nobody to persecute, so that's not right. And it's not right that he invented the idea that Jesus' death and resurrection brought about salvation, because that's what Christians were saying before him. The thing that made Paul really key, as I argue in this book, is that he realized that followers of Jesus, this Jewish Messiah sent from the Jewish God to the Jewish people, followers of Jesus did not have to become Jewish. You could be a converted pagan and believe in Jesus and in the God of Jesus, but you didn't have to adopt the ways of Judaism. You could be a converted pagan and believe in Jesus and in the God of Jesus, but you didn't have to adopt the ways of Judaism. And this realization made it possible for Christianity to move away from being a sect within Judaism to being a worldwide religion. And if that hadn't happened, then Christianity would have ended up with the kind of historical significance of other Jewish sects. And they'd be as historically significant as the Sadducees or the Essenes, who, you know, which are groups that are important for historians of ancient religion, but they're not exactly the sorts of things people worry about these days. And so he made it possible for Christianity to become what it did, which is the dominant religion of the empire. Paul and Constantine were the two most significant converts in the history of Christianity. And it's an easy case to make with both of them, actually, because without Paul, you wouldn't have had Christianity as a worldwide movement. And Constantine, I mean, he was the emperor.
Tuhan Yesus, berilah aku kekuatan untuk menghadapi hari ini. Semoga Roh Kudus membimbingku agar hatiku selalu terarah dan berjalan bersamamu. Amin.
Sungguh berkali-kali lipat ya dosa mereka. Yang pertama, mereka telah melupakan Allah. Yang kedua, mereka telah menyembah selain Allah. Yang ketiga, mereka telah memfitnah Nabi Allah Yesus Kristus atau Isa Al-Masih alaihissalam sebagai Tuhan. Yang keempat, mereka telah membuat patung-patung berhala pengganti Allah. Dan yang kelima, mereka adalah pewaris pembunuh para Nabi Allah. Dan yang keenam, mereka mengikuti ajaran manusia.
Saya pernah di sini memberikan kesaksian bahwa kekristenan bukan agama. Pendiri agama Kristen bukan Yesus Kristus. Kalau saya ketemu sama tokoh-tokoh agama, mereka berkata, Pak Yohanes, kan Yesus Kristus itu pendiri agama Kristen. Ya salah, Pak. Awal mula kenapa bisa jadi agama? Makanya Google sekarang udah bisa tahu Konstantin jadi agama Katolik, disahkan agama Katolik. Saat itu terjadi, para rasul Kristus sudah enggak ada, sudah meninggal. Sudah tidak ada di bumi lagi. Rasul lagi Konstantin mengesahkan, lihat salib di langit, dia sahkan jadi agama Katolik. Kemudian muncul Martin Luther protes dengan doktrin-doktrin Katolik. Mereka, Martin Luther tidak menyetujui, mereka bikin lagi, jadilah Kristen Protestan. Muncul lagi Calvinis, Armenian, itulah karismatik. Jadi pendiri agama Kristen manusia.
Sahabat-sahabat official, jika kita mencermati penjelasan dari seorang profesor Bible bernama Bart Ehrman yang menyatakan bahwa Anda bisa saja menjadi paganis yang bertaubat dan percaya kepada Yesus, tapi tidak harus mengadopsi cara-cara Yudaisme, seperti itu perkataannya. Nah, dia sendiri bingung Kristen itu ajaran siapa. Nah, mari kita dengar bagaimana polemik tentang Bart Ehrman ini yang kemudian memilih menjadi ateis gara-gara dia merasa bingung mana yang benar, ajaran Yesus atau ajaran Paulus.
Is a slightly complicated question with no definitive answer. Luckily, we have Dr. Bart Ehrman here to shed some light on the subject. Oh, you're very welcome. We are going to dig into Paul and Jesus. Okay, straight away, so we're talking about an upcoming course, obviously. The title question, I had like an existential crisis. My mind was exploding trying to think about this. The sort of like subheading here is, did Paul and Jesus have the same religion?
Yeah, no, it's really one of the key questions. And it's, you know, and I myself don't come out saying that Paul was the founder, but you can see why people would say it. And the reason people say it is because they understand that Jesus preached that a kingdom of God was coming soon, and people needed to repent and prepare for it. They needed to return to God and do the things God wanted them to do so that they would enter into this coming kingdom. And so Jesus' teaching was very much in line with Judaism at the time. As you said, he was a Jew, and he's preaching a form of Judaism, and as he understood to be kind of the correct understanding of Judaism and the correct understanding of the Torah. Christianity doesn't actually teach that per se. I mean, of course, Christians believe in the Sermon on the Mount and the ethical teachings of Jesus and all that. But if you ask Christians today how it is a person will enter into the kingdom, they'll almost always say it's by the death and resurrection of Jesus. So the people who say that Paul was the founder of Christianity point out that Paul preached not the Sermon on the Mount, which he doesn't mention, or the ethical teachings of Jesus, which he doesn't mention, or the things that Jesus teaches. He teaches about the death and resurrection of Jesus. And so if Christianity is based on Jesus' death and resurrection, and Paul's the one who preached that, he's the one who developed that idea, then in some senses, he's the one who started Christianity rather than Jesus. Because if Jesus had just preached his preachings, then, you know, his followers would still be Jews. Of course, Jews could be Christians for Paul, but Paul's taught that it's the death and resurrection of Jesus that matters. And since that's That's not what the historical Jesus was all about. That's why people call Paul the founder of Christianity.
And on that note then, Paul's focus is very much on the death and resurrection, and that's the key to salvation. Why was that not something Jesus preached? Why was that, if he is the, you know, the Lord, the Father of Christianity in that sense?
It gets really complicated because our only sources of information about Jesus are, our only real sources are the Gospels of the New Testament. Mm-hmm. And these are written by followers of Jesus who believed in his death and resurrection and are writing their Gospels to explain why it is he died. Basically, they give the life of Jesus, but then they give the death and the resurrection of Jesus. And the whole, each of the Gospels is moving toward the death and resurrection of Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And so in these Gospels, Jesus himself predicts it's going to happen. He predicts that he's going to die and be raised from the dead.
Mm-hmm.
And so it seems like the Gospel writers, you know, agree with Paul. And to that extent, I think they do. I mean, they also think that the ultimate point of Jesus' life and what ultimately brings salvation is his death and resurrection. And to that extent, I think they do. I mean, they also think that the ultimate point of Jesus' life and what ultimately brings salvation is his death and resurrection. And they're the ones who record the words of Jesus. And they're the ones who record the words of Jesus.
And they're the ones who record the words of Jesus.
Sahabat-sahabat official, inilah yang kami maksud bahwa Bible itu ditulis oleh para penulisnya yang isinya diarahkan kepada kematian dan kebangkitan Yesus. Jadi, apa yang dimaksud oleh Profesor Kristen ini bahwa ada ayat-ayat yang tidak dikatakan oleh Yesus akan tetapi direkam dan diklaim bahwa itu merupakan perkataan Yesus atau Yesus yang berkata sekedar untuk memenuhi nubuatan tentang kematian dan kebangkitannya. Pelajaran Kristus semacam ini yang tidak mungkin untuk dimengerti oleh para jemaat gereja. Jangankan mempelajari atau menganalisa sejauh ini, membaca Bible-nya saja mereka malas. Bagaimana mereka bisa mengerti? Misalnya ayat seperti yang dikatakan oleh Yesus ini, sekalian kita akan mendengar bagaimana penjelasan dari sang profesor.
Akulah roti kehidupan. Nenek moyang kalian makan roti di padang gurun, namun mereka mati. Tapi tidak demikian dengan roti yang turun dari surga. Orang yang memakannya tidak akan mati. Akulah roti kehidupan yang turun dari surga. Orang yang makan roti ini akan hidup selamanya. Roti yang akan kuberikan pada kalian adalah dagingku. Kuberikan kepada kalian agar kalian bisa hidup.
Mendengar itu mereka mulai bertengkar satu sama lain.
Bagaimana bisa orang ini menyuruh kita makan dagingnya?
Aku berkata yang sesungguhnya. Jika kalian tidak makan daging anak manusia dan minum darahnya, kalian tidak akan benar-benar hidup. Mereka yang makan dagingku dan minum darahku memperoleh hidup kekal. Dan aku akan membangkitkan mereka pada hari kiamat.
We don't have Jesus' own writings. We don't have any records of his words outside of these books written by people who believe that his death and resurrection were everything. And so in the Gospels, when Jesus predicts his death and resurrection, it's not clear to historians anyway, whether these are the things that Jesus himself actually predicted, or if his later followers who knew he died and got raised from the dead, and they believe that's what brought salvation, whether they portray him as somebody who's preaching that message. A lot of historians, I'd say the majority of historical scholars, say this was not what Jesus was preaching. He was preaching the coming kingdom of God that would come to anybody who repents, but that later Christianity, in order to explain his death, said it had to happen, and then that's the point of salvation, the death and resurrection.
Mm-hmm.
Since Paul represents that, Jesus represented the other, then they say, well, Paul would be the founder of Christianity.
Mm-hmm. I see. And so in that sense, I suppose they were almost members of different religions in a kind of strange way.
Well, that would be the question is if Jesus is right when he preaches throughout the Gospels, mm-hmm. that a person needs to turn to God, love God above all other things, and love their neighbor as themselves, they have to keep the commandments of God in order to enter the kingdom. If that was right, this line of thinking goes, if that's right, then why would Paul be right that he had to die?
Mm.
All you'd have to do is repent. And so the idea is that Jesus' Jewish teachings of repentance for the coming kingdom are not the same as a religion based on his death and resurrection. And so one way people, scholars have put it for a long time, is that Christianity is not the religion of Jesus. But it's the religion about Jesus.
Mm.
And that they're two different things. And Paul's the one, in this view, who would be responsible for the religion about Jesus. I teach an entire semester long course on Jesus, mm-hmm. and I teach an entire semester long course on Paul. And you could teach another semester long course on Paul and Jesus yeah. and relationship. So this eight lecture course that I do gets these highlights and raises these. I think, you know, obviously I'm a scholar of the New Testament, so I find it really interesting, mm-hmm. but it seems to me to be unusually important. I mean, where does Christianity come from? And if it's not what Jesus preached, wait a second. And so, yeah.
It's fascinating, yeah. I just want to dip back into something again you touched on a little bit earlier, which is this, again, difference between the teachings of Paul and Jesus in Jesus teaching his followers to keep the law of God and about the importance of that. And then Paul essentially saying, it's just believe in death and resurrection, the desurrection. I've shortened that into a new term of my own making.
That's good.
So is Paul a straightforward sort of continuation about what Jesus preached of the law, or are they, you know, fundamentally divergent in what they preach there?
Exactly. Right. Good question. That's the thing I deal with in my course, you know, because some people would say, like, an intelligent Christian who's kind of thought about it and kind of worked it out would probably say, look, the difference between Jesus preaching and Paul's preaching is Easter. And that Paul's living after the resurrection. And so there's continuity between what Jesus was saying and what Paul is saying.
Mm-hmm.
And that there's continuity, but there has to be a difference because of the death and resurrection. It can't be the same anymore, but that there's a clear line of continuity. And other people would say, well, no, it's not actually continuity. Because if you say that Paul and Jesus are saying basically the same thing, but at different times because of Easter, then you're saying it really, they're both talking about the death and resurrection of Jesus.
Mm.
And when you look at it, you know, if Paul's right that Jesus had to die and rise from the dead, then why is Jesus right that you have to repent for your sins?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, so I'll tell you one way I put this in my undergraduate classes. You know, you have this story in the New Testament where this rich man comes up to Jesus, mm-hmm. and he says, you know, what must I do to have eternal life? And Jesus says, keep the commandments. And the guy says, well, which ones? He says, well, don't murder, don't commit adultery, don't bear false witness, and goes through the list. The guy says, well, I've done all these things. And Jesus says, well, then if you really want treasures in heaven, sell everything and give to the poor. And then you'll have treasures in heaven. And so the guy goes away because he's rich. He doesn't want to give away everything. And Jesus, you know, and so, but when you look at that story and you just ask, okay, what do you have to do to have eternal life? Jesus is quite clear. You keep the commandments.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I say, all right, now suppose that same guy came up to Paul 20 years later and said, Master, what do you have to do to have eternal life? Does Paul say, keep the commandments? No. Paul said, he can't believe in the death and resurrection of Jesus. The guy says, oh, okay, he does that. So, you know, is that the same?
Mm.
Oh, it didn't seem like the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Are they completely at odds? That's the question people really have to grapple with. Are they at odds, or is there continuity?
Mm-hmm.
Kami hanya ingin masuk lebih jauh tentang bagaimana pendapat para profesor peneliti Bible itu sendiri jauh sebelum Profesor Paul Erman itu terkenal. Nah, inilah penelitian dari profesor yang mengkaji Bible tentang siapakah sebenarnya Antikristus yang sesungguhnya.
One of the most important verses in the New Testament is Matthew 5:17. In 5:17, Jesus states why he is here.
Matthew 5:17-19 says, don't think I came to abolish the law and the prophets. I came not to abolish them, but to fulfill them. It would be easier for heaven and earth to pass away than for a jot or tittle to pass away from the law.
The law that he is referring to is the Torah, which is the first five books of the Hebrew Bible and what Christians called the Old Testament.
The Hebrew Bible and the prophets Jesus speaks of comprise the foundation of Judaism. Jesus is saying, "Think not that I have come to challenge Judaism, but to fulfill it." Jesus was a reformer. His mission was to bring the Jews back to the old ways of theology. He goes on to say, "You change not a jot or a tittle in Scripture."
What does that mean? That means that a jot and a tittle are the little decorative squigglies that you put onto a Hebrew letter. He says you don't change a, he doesn't say you don't change a law, you don't change a philosophy or a thought or a paragraph or a word or even a letter. You don't change the tiniest little part of the law or the prophets. You change nothing. This is what he wanted, to get back to that practice of what the scriptures say.
Because Jesus is depicted as rebutting in advance Christian beliefs about what Jesus came to do.
Paul says the exact opposite of Jesus. Paul could not convince Jews that Jesus was divine, so he went outside of Israel to the Gentiles. A Gentile is anyone who is not a Jew.
And wasn't getting any place again. For two main reasons. Number one was the dietary law. He restricted the things that they enjoyed and ate all the time. But the biggest one was the circumcision law.
In the first century or so, most all Christians were Jews. But Paul said you don't have to keep the Jewish law. That's a legalism, and you're saved by the blood of Christ, not by keeping the Jewish law. So that he admitted Gentiles without circumcising them, without requiring them to observe Jewish dietary policies or going to the synagogue on Saturday.
As a result, there developed what we call today two confessions or two denominations, Jewish Christians and Gentile Christians.
But it took a long time for that bifurcation to take place. A lot of the so-called Gentile Christian church were Jews, but they didn't continue observing Jewish practices, thanks to Paul.
But the point that I'm making is that Jesus says, "I'm here for this," and Paul says, "I'm here for that." Jesus says, "You change absolutely nothing," and he brings it to an extreme degree. And Paul says, "We don't have to obey those cursed laws. Jesus has freed us from them." Of course, that's not what Jesus said.
Remember, the word apostle was reserved for those who were with Jesus and witnessed his doings. Paul claimed to be an apostle, and the Christian church calls him an apostle. Even though he was not involved or even knew Jesus, he had died long before Paul.
Well, if you take the conventional Christian Lutheran sort of view of Paul, he is a convert from Judaism to Christianity.
Paul not only becomes a follower of the sect he persecuted, but imagines himself to be an apostle and an authority on Jesus.
Out of nowhere, the guy says, "You know, I'm not only a Christian, I'm an apostle. I'm on the level with the guys that Jesus actually taught." And however it happens, he doesn't say in the epistles. The stories in Acts of the Damascus Road are transparently borrowed from the conversions of Pentheus and Euripides the Bacchae and Heliodorus in 2 Maccabees chapter 3, well-known works of the time. But however it happened, he becomes a Christian and decides that the Torah is no longer binding, that Jews may keep it if they wish, but they're grossly mistaken, even to the point of spiritual peril, if they think they must.
He describes himself as being born to the Jewish tradition, but he does not think we should follow the law as Christians. And he's being opposed there by Cephas. A lot of people say it's Peter, who was an actual disciple of Christ. Now, in any argument between Peter and Paul, guess who would have the advantage, right? It wouldn't be Paul. It would be Peter. Peter could say to Paul all the time, "Listen, Paul, I was with Jesus. I was a friend of Jesus, and you are an interloper. You've never even met the guy, right? So who are you to tell me what Jesus taught? I was there, and you weren't. So it's actually interesting that this non-disciple of Jesus ended up being so dominant in early Christianity, because, you know, he never met Jesus by his own account. Everything he got from Revelation.
How are we to verify that Jesus actually revealed anything to Paul? And clearly, a lot of the early Christians did not agree with him.
So Paul insists in Galatians that he was sent by the resurrected Christ and made the point, I'm as much sent as you are. And if you knew Jesus before the crucifixion, that doesn't make a bit of difference. Everything is new now in 2 Corinthians.
Now, this seems to be the tip of an iceberg, though, where he's trying to decide a larger issue. If these Gentiles who really like our new religion want to join but don't want to become Jews, and this is very common, there were loads of Greeks and Romans going to the synagogue every Sabbath, and they said, this is great, this is better than the pagan garbage we were brought up with, these bed-hopping deities and so on. These people have a real faith here. But to tell you the truth, I don't want to get circumcised, I don't want to stop having shrimp cocktails and ham sandwiches. Do you mind if I just attend and listen to the scripture and the sermons? And the Jews said, come on, no problem. You're not Jews, but that's all right. Well, that's the kind of issue facing Paul. I got these people lining up to be baptized as Christians. Do I have to tell them they've also got to be circumcised and no more ham sandwiches? Because if I do, they're going to leave. Can it be that important?
This raised a huge problem with the Ebionites.
They said, look, I mean, it may not be the most important thing, but Jesus is the Jewish Messiah. I mean, what's the last thing you think the Jewish Messiah is going to do? Is say, let's just drop the Torah of Moses. We don't have no way. This is all right. It's the least of the commandments, but there's no way the Jewish Messiah is going to say that Jewish law is unimportant. So they said this Paul is an antichrist. He's a false apostle. He's a servant of the devil, especially the Ebionites. Oh, they really hated him. Is unimportant. So they said this Paul is an antichrist. He's a false apostle. He's a servant of the devil, especially the Ebionites. Oh, they really hated him. Is unimportant. So they said this Paul is an antichrist. He's a false apostle. He's a servant of the devil, especially the Ebionites. Oh, they really hated him. But Matthew did too.
But remember what Jesus said. I keep saying, Matthew 5:17, think not that I have come to destroy the law or the prophets, but to fulfill them. And then he goes on, he says, you change nothing. So, critically, if somebody today wanted to be a true advocate of Jesus, he'd be a Jew. That's what Jesus was. If he wanted to be like Jesus, he'd be a Jew.
Jadi, jika kalian ingin menjadi pengikut Yesus, maka kalian setidaknya harus mengikuti cara-cara Yahudi. Akan tetapi hal tersebut tentunya tidak mungkin karena Yahudi sangat membenci Yesus. Nah, satu-satunya agama yang ajarannya mirip dengan Yahudi adalah Islam. Karena Islam juga menganut monoteisme dan Islam sekaligus memuliakan Yesus sebagai Rasul utusan Allah sekaligus mengikuti ajarannya. Sampai di sini, apakah Pendeta Ezra Soru dan Bill Pahit sudah paham? Sahabat-sahabat official, dari video-video yang kami tampilkan di sini, apabila umat Islam yang menyampaikan atau mengatakannya, pastinya mereka tidak akan menerima dan sebaliknya mereka akan framing serta mengatakan bahwa saya ini seorang yang goblok dan biadab. Sebenarnya kami tidak membenci Kristen ya, tidak ada kebencian terhadap Kristen. Kami hanya ingin menunjukkan fakta dan data. Karena dari kalangan kekristenan sendiri justru malah menyatakan bahwa Paulus itu adalah seorang rasul pendusta, bahkan dianggap sebagai seorang yang anti terhadap ajaran Yesus, atau biasa kita kenal dengan sebutan anti-Kristus. Jadi seperti itulah ya sahabat official. Sahabat official, jika Pendeta Ezra Soru sedang sehat dan normal akalnya dan kesadarannya berada 100%, tidak lebih dan tidak kurang, maka beginilah ucapannya sebelum dia dirasuki Roh Kudus untuk memimpin jemaat di gerejanya. Semoga jemaatnya tersadarkan bahwa apa yang dikatakan oleh Pendeta Ezra Soru ini benar sesuai dengan Bible-nya.
Paulus itu sebenarnya rasul pendusta. Dan karena itu kekristenan itu tidak lebih dari sebuah iman kepada dusta, karena kekristenan tidak berdiri atas ajaran Yesus, tapi sebaliknya atas ajaran Paulus yang penuh dengan dusta.
Video ini tidak salah, karena memang ada kaitannya apakah Rasul Paulus itu pendusta atau tidak. Itulah jawabannya bagaimana penjelasan dan studi serta analisa dari para profesor Bible sendiri. Hal ini sudah menjadi polemik di tubuh kekristenan sejak lama. Maka, jika umat Kristen bertanya kepada kami, lantas ajaran manakah yang paling benar? Maka, kami akan tunjukkan bagaimana dahulu Allah telah menantang terhadap para ulama Yahudi dan Nasrani terdahulu. Sebagaimana Allah berfirman di dalam Al-Quran Surah Al-Baqarah ayat 131 sampai dengan ayat 137. Ingatlah ketika Allah berfirman kepadanya Ibrahim, berserah dirilah. Dia menjawab, aku berserah diri kepada Tuhan semesta alam. Dan Ibrahim mewasiatkan ucapan itu kepada anak-anaknya. Demikianlah pula Yakub. Wahai anak-anakku, sesungguhnya Allah telah memilih agama ini untukmu. Maka janganlah kamu mati kecuali dalam keadaan muslim. Apakah kamu menjadi saksi saat maut menjemput Yakub? Ketika dia berkata kepada anak-anaknya, apa yang kamu sembah sepeninggalku? Mereka menjawab, kami akan menyembah Tuhanmu dan Tuhan nenek moyangmu yaitu Ibrahim, Ismail, dan Ishak, yaitu Tuhan yang Maha Esa, dan kami hanya berserah diri kepadanya. Itulah umat yang lalu. Baginya apa yang telah mereka usahakan dan bagimu apa yang telah kamu usahakan. Dan kamu tidak akan diminta pertanggungjawaban tentang apa yang dahulu mereka kerjakan. Kemudian di ayat selanjutnya, dan mereka berkata, jadilah kamu penganut Yahudi atau Nasrani, niscaya kamu mendapat petunjuk. Maka katakanlah tidak, kami mengikuti agama Ibrahim yang lurus dan dia tidak termasuk golongan orang-orang yang menyekutukan Allah. Katakanlah, kami beriman kepada Allah dan kepada apa yang diturunkannya kepada kami. Dan kepada apa yang diturunkan kepada Ibrahim, Ismail, Ishak, Yakub dan anak-anak cucunya. Dan kepada apa yang diberikan kepada Musa, Isa, serta kepada apa yang diberikan kepada nabi-nabi Tuhan mereka. Kami tidak membeda-bedakan seorang pun di antara mereka. Dan kami berserah diri kepadanya. Maka, jika mereka telah beriman sebagaimana yang kamu imani, sungguh mereka telah mendapat petunjuk. Tetapi, jika mereka berpaling, sesungguhnya mereka berada di dalam permusuhan denganmu. Maka, Allah mencukupkan engkau Muhammad terhadap mereka dengan pertolongannya. Dan dia maha mendengar lagi maha mengetahui. Sahabat-sahabat official, jadi ajaran yang terjamin benar adalah Islam. Nabi Muhammad SAW mewarisi agama Nabi Ibrahim, seorang bapak dari tiga agama besar di dunia ini, yakni Islam, Kristen, dan Yahudi, bahwa tidak ada keraguan di dalam Islam. Islam adalah pemenang di dunia hingga ke akhirat nanti. Dan bagi jemaat Kristen yang cerdas dan sungguh-sungguh mencintai Yesusnya, pastinya mereka akan memutuskan untuk menjadi seorang mu'alaf dan mengikuti ajaran Yesus yang sesungguhnya.
Allahumma inni as'aluka bi anni ashhadu annaka antallah la ilaha illa anta antal ahadus samad lam yalid wa lam yulad wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad.